What's my key to not embarrassing myself, Christian?
Don't pass out.
Well, look at us. We have gone from the studio to the racetrack. Welcome to the Jackie Redmond Show. We are here for the St. Pete Grand Prix, and we have lots of surprises in store. We're going to talk to a couple of drivers who also happen to be major hockey fans. Plus, I'm actually going to take a lap around this track at top speed. I'm excited, but also legitimately very nervous. I am super excited for this episode, and again, a little bit scared, but I'm gonna go find my ride. Let's go. All right, we are on the track in St. Pete's. My guy Christian is gonna take me for a spin in the pace car. You've obviously driven this before, right?
Never.
Oh, okay, wonderful. Well, I'm not gonna ask any more questions that I don't want answers to, so let's get in the car.
Let's go.
And do this thing. Oh, wow, gentlemen, too.
Close.
My guy, thank you. I'm nervous.
Don't be, you'll be fine.
What happens if you leave the windows down?
It's just gonna be very noisy in here.
What are these seatbelts?
Okay. What do you mean, what are these seatbelts? You like, those
okay,
are the
I'm putting all the
normal
seatbelts in this thing.
Most important part. What's my key to not embarrassing myself, Christian?
Don't pass out.
No guarantees. Literally no guarantees, but all right. Wait, how does this even go in? Hang on. Okay.
It's because they
all
have
right.
Some other...
Pray for me. Is it more badass to not hang on to the handle, though?
You'll figure that out.
Okay. I gotta play it cool here.
Turn one, which is... This is the main straight. This
okay.
is where we brake the hardest in the car. Also where we reach the top speed.
Okay.
So we can actually brake. Because I was worried if they were going to be out on track, we had to take
whoa,
care
whoa,
there.
Whoa. Don't be throwing out terms like worried.
Is this in the mode it needs to be in?
This is making me more nervous. Are you joking around right now?
No.
Or are you actually asking? Okay.
I have not driven a manual until ever.
I feel like you're messing with me.
No,
are
no,
you
I
trying
have...
to make me more
no,
scared?
No, but that's
I mean, I know he's a professional driver. I know I'm in good hands. But
so there's a thing in Denmark, when you take your driver's license,
yeah.
You have to take it with a manual to be able to drive both types of cars.
That's actually a really smart way to do it.
Grand Prix actually.
What was your time, do you remember?
Qualifying was actually
my heart was in my stomach because I was picturing in my head I would be catastrophic and picturing the car like tip over.
This car has a lot of grip. The one thing I was worried about, because this is a front wheel drive that I'm aware of.
Okay.
But I was afraid of exposing the rear to the point where you start drifting.
And what does that feel like?
It's fun. It's fun when you're in control of the car.
Yeah.
But what's most important is a front wheel drive is something my dad told me when he was racing.
Okay.
If you expose the rear, always just add throttle when it's a front wheel, because it straightens itself out.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Are we allowed to go for lap two?
No.
Aw, damn.
I want to do it again.
I'm stuck.
This thing has more grip than I expected it to have.
Jackie has been to exactly one IndyCar race before this, the Honda Indy Toronto.
Yes.
Who is the defending winner?
Yeah, who is?
A little birdie told me it's you, sir.
Yes.
Which made me feel more comfortable getting in the car because I was like, okay, he won in Toronto. I lived in Toronto for a long time. That's the universe telling me that this is going to be okay. You know?
It's going to be
great.
I wish it was that easy, though.
We've done the lap, and now you're taking me to turn one. We hear a lot of people talk about turn one. People like to sit around turn one. But as a driver, when you're getting ready for a race, how do you prep for turn one? Like, what's involved in that?
Turn one is always the most exciting corner of the whole race, really.
Okay.
Because it's a big braking zone. Obviously, we're two side by side going into one in the start.
Yep.
And that's when all the cars are closest together. So that's where the big chaos can happen. We've seen cars roll over. We've seen cars spin. And
you're fighting for positions. So
exactly. Everybody is trying to. That's where you can gain up multiple positions without really losing anything.
Right.
But it is also the biggest risk.
Okay.
And going into turn one on a qualifying lap, for example, that's where the high commitment. We always try to break those, because I'm a European, I go in meters. We try to break 5 meters later and carry as much speed in, but trying to make sure that we keep the minimum speed high and get the good line for the next. Because as you can see, it's two right-handers before we go into a left-hander.
Right.
So you kind of want to stay as far to the right as possible to open up that left-hander.
Okay.
So we're basically always looking a corner ahead.
Okay, that makes sense.
Except down the straight. That's kind of our breathing moment. Like, okay, like, relax. Okay.
Figure out where you're at and how you can make up time or whatever. But do you always come out and walk the track?
We always do a track walk.
Okay.
Some people tugger it, which is this little cart that we can drive in, but we can sit multiple people on. And the only reason why we really do that is for the straights.
Okay.
Just to speed up the process.
Okay, but while you're walking out here, is there anything specific you personally are looking for?
Track changes.
Okay.
Always track changes. I was out for a run here earlier today just to, before even the team even landed, because I got in 2 days before they
early
did.
Early bird.
I came here just to see, because there's corners that's been resurfaced. They put down new tarmac
on
the track.
So when you say track changes, you mean from last year?
Yes.
Yes.
Obviously this curb, they're gonna try to replicate it as close as they can compared to last year, but it might be a little more to the left, a little more to the right. It's limited what we can really see, you know?
Of course.
Whenever you're out there, you're going 150 miles an hour, you don't see these little details, which is what we're out here looking at beforehand.
I'll tell you what, the curbs were the scariest part, because in my mind, I was like, is he gonna hit that curb? But no, you're a pro. You're just getting as tight as possible around those turns. Okay, so obviously this is a hockey show that you're being featured on right now. A little crossover, we love that. You're from Denmark. I assume you've been to a hockey game before?
I've been to a few.
Okay, NHL games or?
No NHL games, unfortunately. I've been to one, a champs game in Denmark when we hosted that.
Okay.
Which
so
was
like
a
world's game?
Yeah.
Okay.
Which was a very interesting experience.
Okay.
Because I think that must have been my first ever one, which was really, really interesting. I've been to a few locally in Indianapolis where I live.
Okay.
Which is obviously one of the lower ranks.
Yeah.
But it's fun. I mean, I've always watched highlights on YouTube, all these kind of things. So you know what the game's about. And it's a little bit the same with American football. I don't really understand the system, but I know what the game is.
Right. So what do you like about hockey? Is it like when you're watching highlights on YouTube, is it the skilled guys, the goals, or is it the physical stuff, the fighting, the hits?
Take a wild guess.
My guess is that you like the physicality of the game.
Of course, I think it's a team sport, but what I really like about it is even if it does get rough, people stand up for each other.
Yes.
Right? And I like that aspect of it, because it's ideally the same here. You know, as teammates, yes, we're racing against each other, but we also want to try to help each other's race as much as possible in case, okay, one guy is a lap down, you want to try to help each other to achieve the best results. So I kind of align those two together in that way. So it is interesting.
They're very different, driving a race car and playing hockey. But I think what gets lost for a lot of people that aren't super knowledgeable about racing is the physical fitness aspect of what you do.
It's super tough to explain because people don't see us as athletes, really.
Which is wrong, yes.
Whenever they repaved Laguna Seca last year, which is in Monterey, California, it was a super slippery and slick track before that.
Okay.
And then they put this new asphalt on the track, which was super grippy, and suddenly the steering torque, the steering weight, the physical weight went up by almost 25 pounds from the year before. So ideally, we have to sit there and turn 24 pounds more than we did the year before. So ideally, you need to be in shape, you need to be able to turn the wheel.
Right.
But we also need the cardio. In IndyCar, compared to, for example, just F1 as an example, they have power steering, so they don't really have that torque. But for us, it's the physical aspect of the duration of the races can vary up to 3 hours.
Yep.
And for us, we are flat out every single lap. So like in the pace car, we are like that for 2 hours straight.
Wild.
With no break. Obviously, we do our pit stops, but there's no physical cool down. It's just go, go, go. And that's what makes it super physical that people don't really understand because they haven't experienced it.
So when you, this might be a really dumb question, but when you get a race car, I assume you're like, it's like post-workout. You're sweaty, you're this, you're that. So how much water weight do you think you sweat out in a typical race?
It can be up to 4 or 5 pounds pretty easily. So we gotta hydrate for sure.
Okay, my last question. First of all, you have to get to an NHL game. We gotta make that happen somehow.
Please do.
Because there's nothing like it. But second
in
of all.
In Toronto.
See, my guy, this is we're on another level now. You gotta see Austin Matthews in person, an amazing player. So the trophy in hockey is the Stanley Cup. One of the most famous trophies in sports, right? And when people win it, they usually drink or eat something out of it. If you ever had the chance to go to some sort of Stanley Cup celebration, maybe you become friends with Austin Matthews and he wins a cup, knock on wood. I'm a Leafs fan, so I have to be careful I don't jinx it. What would you eat or drink out of the Stanley Cup? It's like a big bowl if you've never seen it.
I don't think I've actually ever seen it.
Oh my gosh. Okay, we're gonna
That's embarrassing. But as an IndyCar driver, I have to say milk, don't I?
Okay, maybe cereal. You can mix milk.
Drink and eat at the same time, right?
Yeah, you cover two birds, one stone.
No, I mean, obviously, that's a tradition with the Indy 500.
Okay.
Winners drink milk, so I kind of...
So you put some chocolate milk, though, or regular?
I don't think we're allowed to put chocolate milk in.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
We have to choose, but I don't think we're allowed to, unfortunately.
Okay, so you're from Denmark. If you could eat something out of the cup, what would be like a dish from your native land?
I would eat ice cream. Ice cream is my go-to.
Okay, what kind?
Vanilla.
Wow.
I don't know. It's just nice classic. And simple, and you can always eat it.
Traditional, classic, it always works. Christian, thank you for keeping me safe.
You're
welcome. I appreciate you. You are very good at what you do, and we appreciate the time. So best of luck this weekend.
Thank you.
All right, we are very excited to welcome Marcus Ericsson to the show, who is a race car driver that also happens to be a diehard. Is that saying too much? Diehard hockey fan?
Diehard. I'll take that.
I love my hockey. I've done my research. I can ask you anything, I think, and you'll be able to handle the questions. But let's talk about you first and what you do, because it's not a big deal. You have won the Indy 500 before, and you're getting ready for a new season. So what does it entail the week leading up to your first race? Is it different than the rest of the year, or how are we feeling?
I think everyone here is super excited because of the first race of the season. It's, you know, excitement in the air from everyone. For me, especially this year, because I've joined a new team, so I'm changing teams for this season, so that makes it even more exciting, if that's possible. So. And then on top of that, being the defending winner of this race here in St. Petersburg. So yeah, it's a lot of good things happening and hopefully will happen this weekend.
Yeah, and you are the defending champ here in St. Pete. So I'd be remiss if I didn't ask, what do you love about this course and what makes it tough?
For me, what I love about this course and street courses in general is the fact that you want to be this close to the walls everywhere without hitting the walls. And you know, the margin for error is pretty much zero. And I love that challenge where you have to sort of try and find the limit without going over it. And that's something that this course really has. It's super twisty and tight, But it's a challenge that I really enjoy.
What drew you to racing in the beginning? Like, how did you get into it?
I don't come from a racing family, so it wasn't like natural for me. But what I sort of loved about the first time I tried a go-kart was the speed. Like, I love the speed.
So you were a bit of an adrenaline junkie?
Yeah, I think so. But also, probably what made me more interested was the competition. You know, like, just try and beat the other guys. Like, that was, for me, what really got me really going. Like, the speed, yeah, it's great. But, like, it's the competition that I really love.
Well, obviously, you thrive well under the pressure of competition. I want to talk to you about the steering wheel, because I was looking at some of the cars. The steering wheel has a lot of buttons on it. So I'm very curious as to what... Explain this to me. How do you navigate this at top speed?
So it's like a very advanced computer game.
Let's put it that way.
Yeah, so we have, obviously, as you can see, a lot of buttons here. Three different rotaries that has different positions that you can switch. The rotaries, if we start with them, are for mostly engine settings. So you can tune the engine to, you know, save more fuel or use more fuel, different throttle settings, stuff like that. So that's how you use them. And then we have pit speed, so it basically is limiting your speed in the pit lane.
Okay.
You have H2O for water or drink. You have overtake button to get extra speed.
Okay.
Neutral, push to talk, so I can yell at my my team in pit lane if they do something wrong.
Love that. Are you a really talkative guy?
No, that's the thing. I don't really do that a lot. I like to get a lot of information. So okay. Over the radio, you know, the pit wall can speak to me.
Sure.
So I like to get a lot of information. I don't tend to speak so much.
Okay.
If I speak, you know,
something's gone really wrong.
Yeah, exactly. So but yeah, that's like a basic view of it. But yeah, pretty complex. And then we have different pages here that show, you know, lap times, split times, different settings. So
okay. It's, what button do you use the most, do you think?
I would say that one. Overtake.
Overtake.
We want to overtake. We want more power.
So you use that more than water.
Yeah. Water we have time to do after. So yeah, that's pretty much.
Who cares?
Pretty much
drink after you win the race.
The champagne,
right.
Exactly.
Exactly. All right. Well, obviously this is a hockey show. And when I started looking into you, you're not just an athlete or a celebrity that likes hockey. You legitimately love hockey. So where did that start? I mean, you're from Sweden. So
exactly, yeah.
I'm Canadian, you're Sweden. Hockey is very popular where we come from. So have you always liked it?
I've always loved hockey. It's, you know, racing is my big passion. But apart from that, hockey is pretty much as close of a big passion for me as it could be. I started to play when I was, you know, 3-4 years old.
Okay.
I played all the way until I was 16 years old. I was a goalie.
Okay.
And I was like, you know, at that point where you sort of either have to go pro in hockey or try and go pro in racing, and I had to pick, and I picked racing, which was a good pick, you know.
Yeah.
Like, I was pretty decent hockey goalie, but I was, you know, not as good as racing.
Yeah, I think you made the right choice
for
based
sure.
on what has transpired
sure.
since you made that decision. But you're a goalie, and I find goalies fascinating.
They're a bit...
You're a bit kooky up there.
Yeah,
you're
for
admitting
sure.
this,
yeah.
right?
100%.
So what were your goalie-like tendencies as a player? Were you superstitious? Did you talk to your posts the way that we've seen, like, Marc-Andre Fleury kind of tap the post after, you know, the puck goes off the bar? He's always thanking the post. Did you do any of that stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I was tapping my posts always before the game or before the period, for sure. And then, I don't know, I liked being a goalie because I felt like you can make a difference. You know, the goalie is always the person that can really win you or lose you a game. So I always liked that with being a goalie, being that guy that could sort of do that for your team. And I just loved it. And you know, it was really sad when I had to stop. But even though after, you know, I still follow hockey in Sweden and here in the NHL as well. So I'm very happy. That was one of the big things moving to America.
Yeah.
I was like, yes, I can watch NHL every night.
Yeah, and you can watch it at a decent hour,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Like a time that
I don't have to wake up at like 4 a.m.
Is that when they would start in Sweden?
Yeah, like 2 a.m. or 4 a.m. Yeah.
Wow, that's dedication. If you're watching hockey games at 2 a.m. over in Sweden, you really do love the sport. I did see, you know, you have made the most of your platform and your persona and your notoriety by getting involved with a lot of teams. I know that you know a lot of the Swedish guys that play. And I saw that you got on the ice, I believe it was with the Ducks, and you played goalie?
That's right, yeah. I did go out. So I'm a really good friend with Hampus Lindholm, who used to play for the Ducks for many years. And it was a couple of years ago when I was over there visiting him, and the team was sort of talking about me getting on the ice, and I was like, yeah, let's do it. So I got the full, I think it was John Gibson's old gear, so his full gear. went out on the ice. It was Hampus, it was Seagrass, and a few others that
did
were playing.
Did Seagrass try the Michigan on you?
I don't know. He tried a lot of things. I wouldn't let anything pass me, you know. I was, you know.
Oh, so you did
out.
Well.
I don't know. I think they were nice and sort of shot at me instead of, you know, in the goal.
They were making you feel good.
Exactly.
Pumping your tires
it
a little bit.
Got my confidence up. But yeah, it was fun. A lot of fun.
Understandably so. I also saw that you got to hang out with Henrik Lundqvist, who I imagine you thought was amazing when you grew up watching hockey. What's it like to hang out with Hank?
It's very cool. You know, he was one of my big idols growing up, not only because he was a goalie, but also because the person he is, you know, like on and off ice. So for me, he was a big inspiration, and to have had the chance to hang out with him a few times and get to know him a little bit, it's been really cool. So. Yeah, going to, I think it was last winter, I went to the Madison Square Garden and watched a game together with him and his daughters. That was like super special.
What do Marcus and Hank talk about in that situation?
The cool thing with him is that he's really into racing as well. So like liked cars, so it was a very natural conversation where we would talk about hockey but also racing. So that was a lot of fun.
And you recently were at a Hawks game.
That's right.
What was that experience?
That was super cool as well. You know, one of the original six. I've always wanted to go to a Hawks game, so. You know, they're not having the best of seasons, and and Bedard was injured as well, so it was a bit of a downer. I know. But it was still a really cool experience, and just to see the dedication with all the fans there was really cool. So, yeah, I'm trying to tick off as many, you know, teams as possible. So I got the Rangers, I need to go to Boston and see Hampus play there, so, you know, that's on my list.
Garden.
Yeah, I've been to the Colorado, Avalanche, over the Ducks, LA Kings. Forgetting something.
And
now,
I understand you collect jerseys a little bit.
I do.
How many different jerseys do you have at this point?
So what is it? I got the Chicago. I did a swap with Landeskog. Got the Rangers.
Landy, no big deal.
Yeah, Bruins.
You got
Ducks.
You got any Leafs jerseys?
No, not Leafs yet.
Yeah, we haven't got there yet. Yeah. He's a Bruins. I mean, are you a Bruins fan? Like, do you have to pick a team?
Yeah, if I have to pick a team, I pick the Bruins. I gotta go with my boy Hampus, you know.
Well, who do you think is gonna go further in the playoffs this year, Boston
Bruins.
Or Toronto?
Of course, the Bruins.
I mean, I want to disagree with you, but I'm traumatized as a Leafs fan, so I can't even disagree with you.
I do think the Leafs have a really good team, and William, my fellow Swede, he's doing really well. You know, he's having a good season, so. Potential is there, but you know, Leafs and playoffs.
I know. If they end up facing each other, we're going to be at odds.
I might have to go and watch that game or that series.
You would have to get to a game for sure if the Leafs and Bruins happen to line up somehow in the postseason. So tell me some of your favorite players. I know you watch the Swedes, but outside of the Swedes, like who do you seeing highlights of?
Yeah, I mean, McKinnon. Really
Matthews,
fun to watch.
I
know Erik Karlsson a bit, and I love to see him play from the defense. You know, just being such a different kind of defender, you know, and that's, I think, is really cool to watch. Sid the Kid, I've watched him a lot. Yeah, I like the Swedes, you know, I like the Swedes. I follow the Swedes and see how they do.
Actually,
Leo Karlsson, the new kid in the Ducks.
Yeah, he's great.
He used to play for my team, Örebro, back in Sweden.
Okay.
So he's, I followed him a lot in Sweden, so it's really cool to see him do well now in the NHL.
And what do you love about hockey? Are you like, do you like the skill players? Do you like the physical? Like, at a game, what's the best part of seeing a game?
I mean, because I was a goalie, I like to see good goalies.
Okay.
Like, Dominik Hasek was a big idol of mine.
The Dominator? Come on.
So yeah, I like to see good goalies, but then, you know, you want to see the extra thing. So that's why you want to see, you know, those guys that can make the extra magic out on ice. So that's always fun.
Who's your favorite goalie right now to watch? Yeah, to pick one. You got Igor.
I met Big Fred Anderson.
Okay, yeah.
And I think he's, I try and sort of watch him a bit. We have a few good Swedes, you know, Henrik, unfortunately not anymore. Ullmark played really well for the Bruins last year. He hasn't had as good of a season this year,
well,
I think.
Well, hard to replicate last year. So you're a Bruins fan, which I don't like, but I'll forgive you. Have you ever seen the Stanley Cup before? You went to the NHL head office last year?
Yeah, I did go there, and I have seen it, and it's very cool. So yeah,
So if Hampus were to win a Stanley Cup, right, I assume you're getting the invite to the cup party.
100%.
Right? Like, if he doesn't invite you, friendship over.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, that is very true.
Okay, so obviously you know the tradition of eating and drinking out of the Stanley Cup.
Yeah, I'll join in on that.
What would Marcus Ericsson want to eat out of the Stanley Cup?
Oh, Swedish meatballs, probably.
Oh, that's a great choice, actually. I don't even know. I'd have to look to see if any Swedes have done that in the past. I imagine they probably have.
I mean, that's what we do, right? So, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I hope so. I don't know.
Last question for you. I need a prediction. We'll see if we can remove your Bruins bias.
Oh.
But Stanley Cup final, who do you think will meet in the Stanley Cup final this year?
I think it'll be Bruins and Avalanche, Colorado.
Oh, Bruins Avs. That would be an interesting one. It would be great. If the Bruins go to the final, you have to go.
Or maybe Rangers. Rangers could be fun as well. I don't know.
They'd have to beat your Bruins to get there.
I know. Yeah. Let's see. I'll watch it.
All right. Listen, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Hopefully, my Leafs will meet your Bruins.
Sounds good.
Once again, at some time in the postseason, and we beat you. But thank you for this. I appreciate the time. Best of luck this season,
too. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
And that is a wrap from the Grand Prix of St. Petersburg. It has been an awesome time to be out here to take my first lap. Thank you to Christian for keeping me safe. He did say I'm ready for a two-seater, so maybe producer Matt can make that happen for season number two. Also, shout out to Marcus Ericsson. Even though he's a Bruins fan, I won't hold it against him. Be sure to tune in next week. Who knows where I'll be at this point? I could be anywhere. Thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you later.